greet you all that have joined us via the live audio stream or the visual. We greet you all in the precious, most magnanimous, powerful name of Almighty Yahweh in Yeshua HaMashiach. For there is no name that's greater than the great name of our Abba. And the strength of his assurance that he grants unto us through revelation of living Torah, Yeshua HaMashiach. What a great blessing, as the old Kiddushim would say, to be one of those that are part of the living, that he has granted us this season, this occasion. We may come into his bayards and to esteem him above all that can be exalted or esteemed. So I do barak. I bow before him. I submit all. I surrender all unto him for the excellence of his truth. For that excellence breaks every shackle. It alleviates us from the bondage of this life, and that we are free because we love the Torah of Yah. We continue in the way of the Torah. He began to open up unto us the knowledge of Torah. And what a great blessing that is, Yisrael Yah, when the minds of the masses of the world, it is blind to what is imat, what is truth. It doesn't understand what truth is. There are traditions that are passed down, but it does not avail. It does not bring forth a mighty strength of nourishment to Yisrael. So that's why we continue in the same pursuits, in the same matter, in the same actions, in the same activities. And our attitude is always the same. It never changes. And one can never see the prognosis of one's own mind and heart. And the reason we don't see that, because we don't make it a continuous, habitual activity to judge ourselves and to look upon the intricates of all the things that we have amassed in our minds and our hearts that we think are right, and yet they are not right, Yisrael. We may perceive them to be right, but they are not right at all. I was sitting here or standing here, and as I thought, as the singing resonated from the bosom of Yisrael, as the old ones would say, what Yefah, he reminds us that he says that we are the elect, the bohir, those that have been selected, chosen by a special process. And it has been processed through the purveyor of the heart of Yah. What is that purveyor? His knowledge, his wisdom, his understanding, his ruach. And so there is a purveyor that passed before his eyes before we were, or I am, or it is. And he elected a nation, a people, having orchestrated nothing that was admirable. Everything that we do, it is vile, repugnant. It stinks. Yet Kephar, he reminds Yisrael, you are elected. How? According to the foreknowledge of Almighty Yahweh. He is our Abba, and he elected us for a process that we would be set apart for his service, that our minds would be set apart to please him. So he ignited our minds with the living substance of the Torah. He gave us a lively tikvah, a promise, a dabarim, a word of words, that a king from his loins to strengthen and elect people. They are the ball here. According to his foreknowledge of all things, he knew before it was known. Before it was conceived, he knew, because he is. And he had in his bosom a foreknowledge, not that he had to process that knowledge or think on the knowledge, because he is all knowledge. There is no knowledge, there is no understanding of knowledge without Almighty Yahweh. You cannot not understand the power of his knowledge, but through Yeshua HaMashiach. And if you don't have the testimony of that power, we are as a ship in the oceans without a rudder. Our course is not dictated by Yah's election, but according to our own thought process or our own thinking that leads us away and arrive from Yah, that we fall into the darkness of every kind of devious, vile, wicked pursuit that is mandated by hell that cause us to turn against Yah. We don't know how to examine ourselves. I don't know which way I will go today, but I will go Yah's way. I will go in, listen, the way. I know what way that my heart has planned, but I will go in the way. I was sitting at the dining hall, the breakfast table yesterday. And of course, little Sipporah, she always, as she finished eating, she will come and sit on my lap. And she was sitting there, and she looks at me, and she says, "Papi, you are wicked. Don't get silly, all right?" So I was intrigued as to what she said. I said, "Yah, she must have been in the home." That was yesterday she said that. I said, "She must have been the ears of my prayer on Thursday night as I uprooted me and the deplorable ways and activities of my mind and my thoughts, how wicked, how vile, how disgusted." You must understand, I talk to me that way. And so I was intrigued with what she said, so I tried to get her to say it again. I say, "What did you say to me, little girl?" And so she began in her dissertation with Abner and Sariah. And I said, "Little girl, tell me, please. Tell me what you said." She says, "Papi, you are wicked." Thank you. She says, "Abner is wicked. And I am wicked. We don't consider ourselves to be wicked. That we have become criminal practitioners against Yah." And so it was not an offense to me as a little one saying something that we become so frightened by their expressions. I wanted to hear it again. "Tell me, little one, say it again to me. What did you tell me?" She said, "You are wicked, and Abner is wicked," just like that. "And I am wicked." That's how she said it. Were there no sins charged to that little one? But we as a people, when someone tells us that we are not walking in alignment with Torah, we take that as an offense, not I. But a man has a motive that is pure and the desire that is sincere and is not manipulated by his flesh, he loves reproof. He loves any kind of correction because it is the sure statement and the zeal of wisdom in a man's bosom. In a time one doesn't want that, it is one that will go against Yah. I will prove that in Torah today, okay? I will show you what the book says. But Kephar, he reminds us that we are elected according to the foreknowledge of Yah, the Abba. He says, and it is a process, it is through the set apartness of the Ruach HaChodesh, the Spirit of Yah. whereby brings us by the sprinkling of the dam of Yeshua HaMashiach unto perfect obedience unto Almighty Yahweh. It caused the eye and the ear to hear. The mental and the spiritual faculties are developed by the Torah of Yah. And so once that is developed, we all have the same laba. We have the same mind. We think the same. We act the same. We walk the same, because there's only one way to walk. And that is in the way. In the Torah delight, there is only one way to walk. And so Yah has elected us by his own foreknowledge, by the obedience through the power of the Ruach, and by the sprinkling of the altar of the dam, the blood of Yeshua HaMashiach. And he said, in that process, the Naham, the mercies, the kindness of Yah, that they may be exponentially upon your life, that they are multiplied upon Yisrael. Well, what is the thing that's multiplied upon us? The heaviness of our sorrows, the disgruntled attitude toward Yah, that's among Yisrael. A nation that is unsatisfied with what Yah is doing. I'm satisfied with you, Yah. I know that everything that presents itself to me, all things work for the excellence, the top of them that are called by the purpose of Yah, that loves Yah, that has this, that have this desire and passion for him. We know that all things work for the tov of Yisrael. All things. Because Yah has ordained the way. And it is through the knowledge of Yeshua HaMashiach, through the afflictions, the trials, the great agonies, Yah has ordained that for us. Because there is one consummate conclusion, that we shall all trust in him. And he's going to prove himself like no other time through the annals of Yisrael, that unless he does the works, it cannot be done. Our prayers are not producing much. Our lifestyles don't produce actually a damn thing. It's full of pretense and falsehood. We're insincere. You know, we will tell one that you are wicked. I lack the bodaciousness of the child, the brassness in her innocence, in her pure little mind, that her concept of wickedness in that immature childlike mind, it is only conveyed through the teaching and the preaching of the one that is bearing her up. And so there are things that have been retained in her mind, that they are genuine and it is truth. And she is only responding to what she has heard, what has been integrated in her little mind to process anything. So she says, you are wicked. Tell me that again, little one. You must have heard my prayers last night. You must have been by my knees when I was there bending and confessing and showing Yah what I am, because he knows what I am. He just wants honesty that you realize what you are, and then you will acknowledge who he is and the power of his might. She said, you are wicked. Of course, when she said that, oh, Abner, he looked at her like, I'm going to tell on you. You should not have said that. And so in her little folly, she played around a little bit. And so I am prodding her to say it just like that again. Say it to me like that again, little one. She says, you are wicked, Poppy. And Abner is wicked. And I am wicked. And so we have this disposition, this hubris arrogance. We can tell others that they are wicked. Yet we have not considered the vileness and the perverse nature of our own bosom. with a vile repugnance. That's why no man is going to be able to buy to Cana. He is not going to be able to Cana. Nor will any man be able to sell unless he has the oath, the promises that he has promised himself. It is mine through this Nahash. He will not be able to redeem himself. He's not going to be able to lift himself from the great agony that shall befall nations that are wicked. They are cursed by Yah. For the curse of Yah, the Ara of Yah, it dwells, it inhabits the house of the wicked. But he blesses the habitation of the Sadiq, the Sadiqa, those that are justified by the dam of Yeshua HaMashiach, not by any works that we have done. For the Torah has done the works for Yisrael. You're not made right because of what you think you have done. I want to read this out of the book. I want to read this. I just want to read it. He speaks unto a nation, Yisrael. He tells us that as Almighty Yah is Berach, he is the Abba of Yeshua HaMashiach. He has shown us the abundance of his Noham, his great mercies of compassion. And he has begotten us not the first time again. He has begotten us or brought us unto his bosom again. And he is going to begotten us again. One more again. One more time. He is going to begotten. He's going to bring them, his house, to his bosom one more time. And then in that season, that time, as Kephar says, he has begotten us to a lively tikvah. We are alive in the promises of Yah Yisrael. It is the Dabarim, the words of Yah, that speaks volume. That speaks of the multitude of his power, his strength, his magnificent excellence. And so we have been brought to that lively, that chayil, that hope of strength, that tikvah of great might, that caused life to pulsate among Yisrael. It's brought us to a lively tikvah, the promises of his Torah. And he has done that through the resurrection of Yeshua HaMashiach. That's the only way. And if he is alive in us, then there is a liveliness that when we hear the Dabarim, the promises of Yah, the words of Yah, the word of Yah, when we hear the Nobi speaks out of the chronicles of the pages, it calls us to come alive. Because we know we're not dead and in the trespasses of sin. And we know that sin has not finished its course, because when sin is finished, it brings forth death, the muth. And the death of muth, it is a prematurely death, because one resists wise counsel. As the old ones would say, the boy is marked for trouble. I see it on the girl. I know their anguish, trouble, and agony upon them. They had no spiritual intuition. They saw the oath. They saw the mark. They saw every sign, and they knew. And so when one would come in the wee hours of the night and say, your son is dead, she would say, I knew that was coming. It was just a matter of time. I knew it. And so she or he had prepared oneself, because they saw every sign. They knew it. And we as a nation, we can discern the sky, when it's going to rain, when the sun is going to shine, The cold weather is coming because your bones are aching, but we cannot discern the time of the coming of Yeshua HaMashiach. And the reason why, because we're full of folly. I'm not, Yisrael, going to stop talking the way I talk. One writes to me, you talk about all of our evil. What an ignorant individual. Because I always show us the process how to get out. He was offended because his sins were revealed and they began to speak profoundly to his wicked heart to show him he is damned. And he is going to hell if he does not get right according to Yah's instruction. So that's why this childlike immature mindset writes to me. I don't allow their stupidity to move me one way or the other. Believe me, Yisrael. He reminds us, I want you to hear this. He let us know that we have not kept ourselves to Shema, to preserve one, to observe, to keep one or to be kept back. He says, Yah has kept us. He has kept, or we are kept, Yisrael, through the power of Yah. Through what? Our emunah, our childlike faith. We don't even have faith, but we are kept by that power. What? The measure that he has supplied every man with. We are kept that way. We are guarded. We are preserved. Yah observes us. He shema. He keep us from falling into the depths of darkness. That our minds are overcome by nahash. That our hearts are given over unto the cesspool of wickedness. We are kept through emunah unto Yeshua, the salvation. He says it's going to be revealed, ready to be made known, to be revealed in the acharit, in the last days, in the time of the coming of my kingdom. When Nahash will rise up, when the serpent, when a mind that is against Yah, as it was against Yahweh and against Moshe, it is a mind that is against Yah. It is a mind that roils at any kind of instruction, the muzah of Yah, to set the order of his heritage right. We're no more our own, Yisrael. We have been purchased by the dam of Yeshua HaMashiach. It's one thing about a wise daughter or a wise son. They always receive the counsel or the instructions of their parents. I don't care how old they get. In the days of man, 60 years old, his father, 75, he will never even royal at him. Yet this is a wicked generation. It has no honor for the Zachin. Those that have an experience with wisdom, the young women rise up, the young men, the older women, the old elderly women. No one wants to hear the counsel of Yah. It is because of Nahash. It riles against Yah. It rises up against the Most High. Yah said the power of this truth is going to be revealed in the acharit, in the last days, in the end, in the gates, when there is no measurement of time at all. And we are coming to that. There is no measurement of time in the sense that the agonies and the heaviness is so great. They are so great that one will think a day is like 10 days or 20 days. There will be no true measurement of time, period. Because of the great agony, we must have one thing in our bosom, in our betim, in our bellies. It is the seat and the faculties of all emotion, spiritually, knowledge, mentality, or mental concepts and spiritual concept. It is in the betim, the belly of a man. And it must rise from the belly of Yisrael. That's why we must hide the Torah in Yah, of Yah, in our hearts. In our minds, that we will not practice sin. You know you're doing evil. Acknowledge you're doing evil and get it right according to the way. You can acknowledge you're doing evil, something is wrong. But you can acknowledge you're wicked, something is wrong in your heart.
When you can't see the shortcoming and the fallacy of your ways, something is sick in your damn mind, Yisrael. When one answer a quiet answer turns away the wrath or the anger of anyone. And we don't think because we talk loud like me, we're not talking loud. And we talk loud. Although we think we're not talking loud. Do children realize they're talking loud when parents say, stop, boy, stop, Ashton, you be quiet. You're too loud. And that's what we are, children. We are the bane of Yah, we're children. We don't realize our activities. And so he goes off again. He's talking low. He's talking. And all of a sudden, the Cassandra of his voice raises again. He doesn't realize it. Neither do we know, Yisrael. We're a nation that take offense to anything that reveals us. I wasn't offended at that child. I'm glad that her mind is that clear. I really am not. I'm glad that my Isha wasn't there because I know what she would have done, or her Ema. I say, I want you to tell me that again, little one. Tell me. You're wicked. Say it again. You're wicked. Abner's wicked. And I am wicked. We are unclean things. Unless it's by the set apartness of her house, then she is an unclean child. And if they do wickedness, then their house, Yah says he will curse the children to the third and the generation of the fathers that sonne, that hates him. We can't get around that, Yisrael. We got to come in at the door that Yah has opened. So he tells us, he said, I want you to rejoice greatly. Gadol, with great emphasis. He said, though now for a time, a season, a period of time, he said, if need be, he said, you are in heaviness through manifold or the many temptation. We know that there's a heaviness, a great agony upon you because of the trials of your mind and the temptation as the enemy tries to exact a toll upon you. But he reminds us that even through all of that, you must realize that the trial of your emunah being much more precious than that of gold, which perisheth. Though it be tried with the ush, the fire, it may be found. See, even through all of that, after you've been tried through all the heaviness and the agony, he said, although it's been tried, though it may be found when the finished conclusion of the matter, he says that it might be found unto praise and honor and kabod at the appearance of Yeshua HaMashiach. Is that only for the case of the last day? It is for the time that when Yeshua appears before us, when his testimony is opened up in our bosom, Yisrael. When you wake in the morning, his testimony ought to be opened. In your sleep, the power of that testimony ought to be opened. In the snares of death, there are those that will not see him at his coming. Their eyes are blind because of sin. And although we have this great heaviness of the trials that we encounter, that our faith, our emunah, may be refined, it is the elect of Yah to cause that process to be in your life. And what it should produce a great praise and honor unto Yah. That's why the old Kedushim in all their ignorance, Yah didn't leave them alone. Through all of the heaviness of great agony, of great laboring, they could come to that house and then they could sing. They didn't have the polluted instruments that have been basically reserved for the wicked. Nothing but their feet, the old piece of tin and a fork, a timbrel if best. And they would sing for hours and shout. And the preacher man would get up for hours and shout. And no one went home weary. And it was the great collective effort among each other to supply community to take care of each other. And now we have become so perverted because of our iniquity. Because of our own avon, our perverse mind, our corrupt wickedness that we store in our hearts, and that's why we never forget it. It is always before us. It is the constant reminder it's going to damn you into hell. Light and darkness cannot dwell in the bed together. Nor bitter and sweet. You can be sweet one moment, bitter the next. It's a wickedness, Yisrael. It is the spirit of Nahash. It is against Yah. It is against Yahshua HaMashiach. It despises anything that Yah says. I want to read a verse later on how he's going to nourish us. How he's going to feed us. He feeds us the same way now as he will feed us in the end, Yisrael. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He tells us, Kepha, I want to read a few verses and I want to really get into the teachings Yah's will today. He tells us to gird up our loins, our minds, the loins of your mind. He said, I want you to be sober and I want you to have tikvah to the kids, to the end. Gird up your mind. We will allow our minds to be controlled by Nahash, a spirit that is causing us through its manipulation to go against what Yah speaks unto us. I will bring the depths of that in a moment. He says, for the chesed, the mercies that is to be brought unto you, see, not at that latter end. We're at the latter end at the keys to the revelation of Yahshua HaMashiach. When Yahshua is revealed unto us, not in a verbal manner, but in a sincere manner of truth. He's in the heart. He's in the mind. You give all to him. There's nothing to live for but Yah's truth. When he is truly revealed unto us. And then we began to walk as obedient children, not fashioning ourselves according to the former lusts and our ignorance. We don't do the things that we once did, our former lusts. In the ignorance of our vile activities. He said, and if we, Yisrael, if we call on Yah, I know how people have used this verse, who is without respect of person. He said, although this one has been prayed up, but if you call on Yah, you must call upon him to confess. I had someone to write me and saying to me, I need prayer of deliverance. But the individual will not confess their wickedness. I haven't responded. I hope the person is listening today. And then the person say, don't condemn me. Well, you already condemned, man. There's not a damn thing I can do to condemn the person. And I say, how amazing that is, Yah. The person will not even confess up and own up to their wickedness. All the person is saying is that I need help. I need deliverance. I need to walk with Yah. Confess your sins. And Yah means when he says one unto another that the effectual fervent prayer of the Sadiq. Who are the Sadiq? Those that have been justified by Yah. That it will avail much. We don't want to do that today, Yisrael. It's because of our arrogance. I will, man. He said, Yah is without respect a person judges every man according to the mitzvah or his works. Passing or past the time of your labor, your sojourning, or your walk here on this earth, he says in fear, in the yirah of Yah. Yes, the fear, the respect, the honor, the trembling. That's what he means. So it is in the house of the Ish and the Ishah, that there should be a fear of reverence and honor to hear. To be quiet and to comprehend what her Ish says. That's the will of Yah Yisrael. If the man be one that is Without the knowledge of Yah, it is be pleased to live with him. If it's shalom to live with him, then you dwell in that house. You are not bound by that circumstance. Same thing with the man. He's not under bondage in that circumstance. If she is not willing, she's not submissive, she's not obedient, then he is free from that woman. If it's no shalom, then he is free. And that's just the order of Yah, whether we buy it or not. And that's just the truth. He gave the woman to be a tremendous strength unto the man. Her voice is a strength unto the man. The beauty of her speech and all of that. And the world has taught Baptist Zion how to walk in the uttermost depravity of wickedness. Their thoughts and their actions, their words are of no regard to Yah. And the most sad thing that they don't even see themselves. And that's the truth. They don't even see how they're walking. What a damnable, vile thing. And then these weak-backed men will coddle their wickedness. Not I. I won't do it. I will not. Not me. They will coddle their wickedness. And they will cause an agony upon his own home. Even wicked men in the day, they may not have been walking right, but they had a strong rod in their home. That's a fact. I've seen that. And she wasn't out doing her fancy flight thing either. And the men that were his associate honored her because they knew she wasn't a fancy fly filly thing. You all might as well say, oh man, whether you do it or not, it makes no difference. I'm reading this because I love the song that the silver and the gold. He says, for as much as you know that you were not redeemed, you young down, you've experienced that you were not redeemed with corruptible things. These liars, these beasts, these kerep, these dogs, they're vile dogs that are telling you to buy silver or gold, it is corrupt. Those that are trying to save their own lives, they're going to lose it. They have no confidence. Who's going to stand against the beast? There's only one mind can stand against that Nahash. That's the mind of Yeshua HaMashiach. We're seeing that in Gaza, in the land we call Israel. I saw a small insert of an article this morning how that the land of those that are the Khazar in that land, they have what they call drones. And they are intercepting the little underdeveloped missiles that are in Gaza from Hamas. And they're raining down terror and hell on that little strip of land. Because they have the military might, they have the backings of all of these wicked nations, and those that are Palestinians are no wicked than those that call themselves Israel. Those that are the Edomites are no wicked than those that you call yourself the Bruce. I'm not taking one damn word back, Israel. They're not Yisra'ya. Because the identity of Yisra'ya, it is a statement that the power of Yah prevails. That's why he has a Shebet. A Shebet. A remnant of the residue. That he shall preserve. He shall guard over. He shall keep. And yet because they have the military power, they're raining down the fire on them. You tell me a little group that they call there that Mr. Bin Laden was the leader, that this little group of people that didn't even have clothing that fit, they didn't even have combat boots. The men there in Afghanistan, Al-Qaeda, they wore sandals. They had the old Malakak, the weapons of Russia that they captured when they defeated Russia in that 7-8 year war. They had no powerful artillery, but they had a will. They had a will and a purpose. I talked to one that was in Afghanistan. He says to me, Reach, it is amazing. He said, the weather, the temperature get down to 15 minus at night. And you find these soldiers walking around in sandals, no socks, and just a little cloak on their shoulder and their weapon. And that's it. The diet consists of a little tea and some bread. They have a purpose. They're warriors. Yet we find one of the most powerful, mighty military arms. Yet it is not able to prevail against Al-Qaeda. They are still as strong. I don't care about the lies of Mr. Barack Hussein Obama. I don't care about the lies of Mr. Netanyahu. I don't care about Prime Minister Britain. It's their lies. They are still strong. They are still moving at a tremendous torrid pace. And then they proposition us and pimp us like whores to make us think that those young men and women in Afghanistan are fighting for our freedoms. We have no damn freedoms. We're bound. You're free to do nothing because what you're free to do equals nothing. Go hell to Walmart, Kmart, Dollar Mart. Go down to the dollar store, you tell me that's something. Sit down and watch television all damn day and your bellies feel like a hog. You get quiet, don't you? And you're free, you're bound, you're in bondage. And I don't take one word back. I don't take my intrusive speech back. And you're free. How free? Free of what? I'm going to preach today. Don't worry. The last time I talked to my natural sister, I felt so sorry for her. Because she says to me, as I didn't know, she began to confess. She told me at night, she named all the drugs she has to take before she goes to bed. She said, I have to take 10 different drugs. I say, well, I'm counting. You're telling me what you're taking. It's 11. Those are the ones she takes at night. And then she takes another 4 in the morning. Zenzeridine, she was naming them off. And she said that I have to take them. Because if I do not, I don't know what will happen. Now, she has her own apartment, she believes. She gets her monthly stapling that the government gives her. She can get on the bus when she wants to and go where she wants to. Where is she going? First of all, she cannot go where she wants to. She goes according to the limited finances she has. And they're very limited. She says to me, when I pay my rent, I pay my electric bill, I pay my cell phone bill, and buy a little groceries, I have nothing. You want to do something for me? I said, no, I need you to help me. Send me some money. At least you got money. I don't have any. You send me some. That's what I said. So she laughed that off. But I feel so sorry for her, how bound and the shackles she's under. So sad. She's no different. The other ones are taking other drugs. She's just taking the drugs that the government gives her free. The other ones are taking all kinds of drugs. The iPad, the cell phones, the YouTubing, the searching, no different. I don't give a damn if you don't agree with me. They're gorging like beasts. They eat without control. They gorge and consume food, and that's their main thing, always eating. Love to eat. Eating all day. I don't see but one thing that does that, and that's beasts in the field. We're not a beast in the field. They're not beasts. They're the only ones that eat all day. Those cows eat all day long. The goats, the sheep, and they get very little sleep, few hours a day. Cow gets maybe 3 hours a little sleep a day, what we will call sleep, if that. Very little sleep. And they're up grazing and eating. And so we are seduced by the drug of Nahash. It bewitches our mind to the point we cannot obey the Torah of Yah. When the Torah commands us accordingly, we must do it. Listen to this. We yada, we have not been redeemed by corruptible things as silver and gold. From our vain conversation, our shav, our lifestyles that are empty. Because it produces the same thing every day. Senseless talk of folly. The same stupidity. It is not a growth. It is not one maturing in the ways of Yah. We look to sleep and to eat and to continue in the same process. From our vain conversation, which we are received by the traditions from our fathers, mama's Baptist way and daddy's Methodist way, the Pentecostal way, the way of falsehood. He said, but we have been redeemed by the precious dam of Yeshua HaMashiach, the Lamb without blemish and without any type of spot. But this is the catalyst here. Who verily for certainty for all men was foreordained before the foundation of the earth. Were we not elect according to the foreknowledge of Yah? Was not he ordained, foreordained before the foundation of any creation? Because he is the word of Yah. And he was foreordained before the foundations of the Erech, the world, but was manifest, he was made known unto us in these, again, in the last times. Is he being manifested unto us? Is Yahshua being made known unto us? Or is it us being made known to me? He shall be manifest in these last days. Was he speaking of that time or this time? He was speaking of that time and that time. Because after the death of Yeshua HaMashiach, we entered into the last days, the kids of Yah. And so he must be made known in these last days. The power of that testimony must be real and not the strength of our old phone, our iniquitous ways. That's why we are called. That's why the love of Yisrael is called not just toward each other. We're called toward Yah. We're called in our offerings. We're called in our prayer. We're called in our association. We're called in our fellowship. I don't give a damn what we say. I could tell a man that has the revival of Yah's sincere nurturing of his great love, or one that goes through the motion of a thing. I understand that. I can see where Beth to Zion, whether she's just going through the process of the emotion or it is sincere in their bosom. A real man When man wants a wife that just goes through the protocol and there is nothing in her bosom. You think the Abba wants a woman that there is nothing sincere in their bosom? Yeshua should be manifested in us in these last days. How about the power of the fruit, the peri of the ruach? And it begins with the great love of Ahava, the love of Yah. Love first Torah above all, to love Yah with all, and to love your neighbor as yourself. Upon those who hinge, that is the strength of Torah. You can never move in the power of Torah until you get there. We have this vile thing we call love. I hate it. I hate it. I have always been an observer. I can tell a lot about a man just watching him. The old ones would say, as they would see old Jimmy Crook walking up the path, you got older ones there. Nobody said anything. And everybody would get quiet. And old Jimmy Crook, he's strolling up the path. He's just walking. And everybody will get quiet. And they'll watch the boys walk. They look at the boy's dress. And the first thing he does when he gets there, he's loud. And everybody else quiet because they're observing. They're watching. How's it y'all doing? How's everybody? And then you will usually find the chiefest of the elders. Most of the people sitting in that little congregation, that circle, they will not say anything. Yeah, we is doing all right, boy. How you doing? That's the way they would respond. Because the others did not want to be interwoven with that same kind of spirit of Jimmy Crook. I know what I'm saying. I could see things as a young lad. I could see the old ones congregated together and watching them. I could tell the one that had the superior strength of all of them. I remember one thing when I saw my natural father. I saw him from a distance. It was about as far as from here to the core pond. And I remember I saw a congregation of men around him. I remember this quite vividly. I was about 23 years old. I did not approach the man. Did not even see or could not even make out his face from that distance. But I knew that that was the man that they call R.J. Nichols. I knew that because one had mentioned that that was him. And so I'm sitting there and I'm watching this man. I'm observing him. He doesn't even know who I am. And I'm watching this man. And I'm watching all these other men congregated. It was about 8, 9 men, 10 around him. And yet he was in the center of that circle. And he is the one that is commanding their attention. And I'm watching because he's commanding their attention. I say, wow, look at that. They all listen to him. And I'm just watching. And I knew I sat there and watched that man for 20 minutes. Just watched him. And they all had a reverence of his command. And they listen to him. So Jimmy Crooks walks up. Well, y'all, I'll see y'all later. And he strolls back down through the path. And nobody says anything. Nobody. Nobody. I know what I'm saying, amen. I know I'm right. And all of a sudden, the elder of that group, he said, y'all, that boy, he's headed for trouble. And before anyone would respond, they were quiet in their response. I was seeing that boy going on yonder there. He's going the wrong way. He's going to end up. They would say, Guana, he's going to. This Guana, end up. And they knew. And then that would be the second tier of the elder. He would say, you know that boy, I tell you. Aza just ain't, you know, so we don't just talk. But Aza knows that boy. He was over the yonder yesterday. Hallelujah. He was over yonder yesterday. And Aza heard that
He going over the other ways and just did it and he did that.
See, the elders of the statement, he's shaking his head. You're right, man. He knows I'm right. Even my Ima back there, she knows I'm right. That's the way it was. And everyone knew that that one wasn't right. They had no spiritual inclination. It was only the habitual activities, the attitude of that one. And they could tell a whole lot. We've lost that. We are supposed to be spiritual. We have the Ruach of Yah. And if we have the Ruach of Yah, it implies that we have the Torah in us. And it's one pulsating power of the Torah. It is a discerner of the very thought and the intent of one's heart. It shows, it reveals. You speak a word. It is one thing that that detectives do when they have suspects. Do not they observe their actions, the way they sit, their hands, their feet? They propose a question to them and they watch how they respond. They watch the twinkle of the eye. They watch the gesture of the hands. They watch the feet. They watch the posture in the chair. And by that, they can deduce a much of an abundance of knowledge about this suspect here. He did it. He did it. And we know if we keep pressing, he's going to eventually confess. And 99.9% of them do confess. You understand? But it is the observation, it is the question they ask that causes what is in one's heart to be rendered out. And so that's what the Torah does. It speaks to us and causes that spirit of Nahash to be rendered out. And it must come out, Yisrael, because it is against Yah. And we must be reminded of that. We're going to die in our wickedness. I don't know how to say it any other way. We're going to die that way. It is the truth, my fuck. We're going to die without the knowledge of Yeshua. We have been redeemed with the precious blood of the Lamb without blemish and spot, who verily was foreordained before the foundation of the world. But he is made manifest in these last days. Listen to this. Who by him, by Yeshua, do we believe in Almighty Yahweh? Because he raised Yeshua up from death and gave him honor, that your emunah, our faith, and our tikva might be in Almighty Yah, in the power of Yah. In Yah's hazach. His hazach is his strength of might, of power, his mighty strength. Who can raise one up from the dead when the body had laid in the grave for 3 days and there was no corruption in that body? It did not rot. It did not stink. The skin worms did not begin to eat on it. As soon as we die, within an hour, less than that, the skin worms are eating. And all kinds of flies, if you lay out there, maggots, overnight you will find all kinds of maggots and flies in that individual. And yet that body was not corrupt. And yet in our own minds, listen, Yisrael, through the power of Nahash, we find all kind of unclean things in us, don't we? Like the child says, Papi, you are wicked. And then she went about doing her little thing. I said, tell me again, little girl, please. I want you to tell me. I want you to tell me. It took about 30 seconds, 45 seconds. And of course, my friend Abner, he's looking at her like, little girl, you messed up. And you're going to get it. I will make sure that you are corrected for that. And so she is playing and she's playing and she says, I said, tell me again, little girl. She says, Papi, you are wicked. And she pointed, she said, and Abner's wicked and I am wicked. I said, she must have heard my prayers last night. We are the wretched thing undone. We must be done. We must be revived. We must, the mercies of Yah, they're renewed daily. They're renewed. We must impel the affections and the lust of our flesh. It begins there. And then your Ruach, and began to perfect the Kadosh of Yah in his fear. You must impale your flesh. You must bring it under subjection unto the Torah of Almighty Yah. That is where Hava messed up. And to understand the depths of that, it must be explained sequentially. Each word, we lose much aspect on things because we don't understand what the words imply. We think we know what it means, but we really don't, Yisra'iyah. We truly do not. I'm amazed when I see the true identity of the phrase of Yah, what it implies and what it means. Now it brings a flow of fresh understanding, and the rivers of his knowledge began to flow. And when that began to flow, it caused me to rejoice that I'm tireless, I'm not tired, I don't give up in the pursuit of the riches of Yah's great gems. But hell, we can dig in a rag clothes pile all day long. We can search the shelves of Walmart, one of the most depraved, slave-driven businesses. It is the only company in America that pays poverty wages. It got it ways of understanding the minimum wages. Because they don't give the people the hours, the time. That's what they do. And that's how they rob the people. They're greedy bastards. Them are children of hell. Every Walton is a child of hell. Every Walton has been raised up by hell. Every Walton will die in the midst of darkness. And in hell, every last one of them will lift their eyes. You cowards, I'm not a coward. You can't say that I just said it. I just said it. Every Walton is going to hell. Every last one of them, from the mama to the grandbabies, they're all going to hell. It is a damn cursed house. It is a greedy, repugnant, wicked house. It is vile. It kills. It steals. It robs. There's a sore evil in the land. Mainly riches kept back by the owners to their own hurt. You know that that woman has worked well. And she cannot even supply bread for her babies. And you dirty bastards can live off of $20-25 billion. You rob her. All Waltons go to hell. Every Walton go to hell. They're cursed. That's why I'm going to continue my teaching. I want the Hebrews to confront me. They're false. They're not Yisra'iyah. They're not prevailing in the power of Yah's Torah. They're not. And I'm not backing down from one of them. They take the susceptible, stupid minds. They construe Torah to meet their needs. Just like the Baptist. Just like the Methodist. The Pentecostal. I don't want to go that way, but I would deal with them. Of course, they don't. They call themselves bruised, but they will say that I got a mental detachment. Spiritually, I'm lost. You understand? But that's all right. I'm still a warrior. All this was foreordained that we may believe in Yah, that our faith and our tikva might be in Yah. For we have this pure hope in us, this tikvah. Kephas says, seeing you have purified your nefesh, that's the only way we're going to make ourselves pure, by obeying not just truth, but the truth. You have purified your nefesh by obeying the truth. Ha-imat-imat-ha. You have obeyed the truth. How? Through the ruach. You cannot obey the truth but through the Ruach of Yah. Through the power of the Ruach. That's why Yahshua said, I pray, I must go. But I pray that the Father, the Abba, shall send you the Comforter. And the Comforter will lead and guide you in all Torah. So we purify ourselves as it was with Moshe. The offering of purification, the cleansing, the sprinkling, the water. It is the same living water. We must purify ourselves in obeying the Torah. How? through this, not through this false, unfeigned, this superficial thing we call love, through love, through unfeigned love of the ark, through unfeigned love of Yisrael, that the strength of the brother's love shall be so strong, it prevails against all opposition. They stand on the mandates of Yah, and everyone that sees them will know that this is a congregation, a fellowship of true Yisraelite. Yeshua said, this is how all men will know you, my Talmidim, that you have loved one toward the other. He was not talking about the Ishaw. He was talking to the Ish, the Ach, the man. That there's a sincere love. It's not something that is false. It's not something that is based upon this little juvenile expression, I love you. It is something of a sincere motivation that pays attention to the smallest of details. We don't pay the attention to the smallest of detail for each other, then we really don't give a damn, Yisrael. We don't care. And that's the truth. And so when we as men, when we have the sure strength in us, we will not have the rebelliousness and the hard-headedness out of those out of the issue. See, when a man loves another man, there's something great. There's a great strength there. There's nothing, but it's one thing. I can sense, I know real love from a man. I can sense the power of it. I sense the sincerity of it. And I can sense the falseness of the superficial damn thing that is not fervent love. I can sense that. I know it's there. I may not say nothing, but I know what's there. You can talk all you want to. I love you. I stand with you. It doesn't mean a damn thing. I've heard many say that. I will come on. And I knew from the spot what they were, but I did not condemn them. I did not annihilate them. I suffered. Do right by all men. Hallelujah. I knew what they were. It hasn't gotten past me. My Ishaw just doesn't run her mouth when I say something to her because she knows better. I may say it to her. I don't even sit around the ark. I just leave it alone. And I watch the process of things. I watch and I look. Hallelujah. You can talk all you want to. And we've made an excellent, we've learned how to master that, how to just talk. Talk, 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 as she says. As the old ones would say, talk and no action, it means nothing. Individual came in and said, I wanted to leave a gift and you didn't let me. You hypocrite. If he wanted to leave a gift, he could have left one. Say, you damn liar. But then why not send a gift then? You left send a gift. He can't even afford to send a gift. Hallelujah. He can't even afford. We don't need no potatoes. They will rot. I'd rather you give them to someone else. That's the truth. We don't need you to buy a few steaks and bring them here. Take them and take them out there and give it to the poor. Because we got steak. We got grass-fed steak. We got deer steak, we got lamb steak, we got chicken steak, we got turkey steak. We don't have to. We got fish steak. So take that and help someone else with it. That's what you do. Sukkot was a time that you know, when people say they want to come, I don't shut the door on anyone. Come. But I would tell you, woman, don't come here dressed that way. Well, you know, the Lord God sent me to this side. I said, well, we don't talk about the Lord God here. Damn God. Damn Jesus. So you know what you're going to get when you come here. Don't hear from them again. But they say their Lord God sent them. Everyone in this generation is spiritual. Yeah. You can tell a lot about a man, his strength, his character, when he presents himself. Sure you can. I can. I know what's in him. Hallelujah. I want to move on this for a moment here. I believe I need to go this way. We have purified our nefesh in obeying in his shemach. We hear with faithfulness to obey, to hear. Obey the truth. How? Through the ruach. Unto unfeigned love, unto true love of Yisrael, the ach. Unto true love for the brethren, for the ach of Yisrael. He says, and see that you love one another with a pure heart fervently. It is a burning and flame, inferno of a fire. That it is so sincere that when we are even in congregation, you can sense that beauty of love. You can sense that. I'm not afraid to love an ark. I'm not afraid to love an ahog. I'm not afraid. There are men that are afraid to love. They don't know how to love. They're all standish and they don't know how to love. They don't want to incorporate or cooperate or be a part. They don't know how to love. There are women that don't know how to love. They're cold. I can sense a cold love from a man. I can sense the coldness in a man. I can watch a man and tell. I can watch one interact with others and tell how cold they are. It is one thing that gives me a sure sign of that is how we interact with the little ones, with our little babes. I can tell. I can tell. I don't care if it's granddaddy, grandmama, auntie, or auntie, or whomever, cousin, whomever. I can tell. I don't care if it's brother, sister. I can look and tell. That's not natural. That's not the normal process of love. You know, other day, I always pop Yesha because he always say, ouch. I do that because I want to hear him say that. I say, you didn't say ouch, boy. You didn't say ouch. So undoubtedly, it wasn't hard enough then. So I give you another one. Ouch, Poppy. And so yesterday, as I popped Yesha, he came to me and he says to me, give me one. Give me one, Poppy. That's okay. I'll give you one too. Give you the rod, the same rod I put on Yesha. You understand? Well, do they determine that that is some kind of aggressive type of hatred toward them? No. They know what it is. They understand that. You understand? They do. Their minds understand that. They can't express what love is, but they know that there's an association there, but whereby they sense not only an honor and a fear, but they sense a security there as well. Yes, that's what love does. That's what love does with brothers, this love unfeigned. It is a fervent love. It is security among each other. You're not worried about the rock doing you wrong. You're not worried about the holds. You're not worried about your words being opposing or coming back to haunt you because she said, you're not worried about that. You have this damn thing we call this false love. And the reason it is false because we don't have a love for Torah. We don't love Yah, Yisrael. And so we don't know how to love fervently. It's false. It is surmising. It is something what we call surmising because we are cold as hell. Because iniquity, what is avon? What is the avon of Yah? It is a perverse nature in one's bosom whereby there is a disdain, a rejection for Torah truth. They despise it when it approaches them or one thinks that it is encroaching upon me. They despise it. They don't like it. They hate it. It is the truth, my amen. Well, you said I was like that. That ain't me. It is you. I don't back down, man. I don't just accuse a man. I know what I'm saying. When I say something, I ponder matters for a long time. I watch it. And then when I said, you better believe me, I know what I'm saying. People go to a psychologist and they tell them and they... The last time I talked to my natural sister, she said, there are things that go through my mind and things that are just basically insane. I say, them drugs are running you crazy, woman. She says to me, I have this doctor. I remember the name Gomez. And when I call her, she always helps me. She tells me what I'm going through. Isn't that amazing how the one that knows nothing about Yah, through some type of scientific methodology, this doctor... And she spoke, well, oh, she is so nice, she's so sweet. And I can call Dr. Gomez at any time and she would take time and she would tell me, I will explain to her and she would tell me what's wrong and what I need to do. And it works every time. That's what she said to me. I said, okay, well, I'll talk to you later. That's what she said. That's what she said. She confesses. She tells Dr. Gomez. She says to me, she says, I was about to do something ugly. These are people, they say they love each other. That's why I tell you, I don't want your love. I don't want it. Just don't love me. Learn how to love him first, and then when you love him, you'll love you. And then, peradventure, someday, before you die, you'll learn how to love me. These are those that how they talk about how great love they have for each other. She says to me the last time I talked to her, she just began to confess. Because she says to me that my aunt's son who killed his brother, he is so sweet. I said, he's a damn beast. He is not sweet. I said it like that. I said, he's a damn beast when a man kills his own brother. You can call him sweet. I will not call him sweet. He's a damn beast. And I will have no dealings with him, because if he killed his brother, he will kill you too, woman. And she says to me, she said, well, I've had my days to, I've done my thing. She says to me, I didn't even know because I don't talk to them. They call me or whatever. And we talk, I return their call. I don't spend hours talking to them or minutes, just okay. And sometimes it's days or weeks before I return it, because I don't want to be bothered. She says to me, her only living aunt, this is a woman, how old is she? 80 some years old. She says, what I did one day, I was acting real ugly. Before my natural brother died, she was telling her, she said, I said to her, I'm going to kill you all. She said, there was propane on the back of the house. I said, I want my brother out here, and I'm going to blow the damn house down. I'm going to, but they love each other. Buff is sweet, and she loves Buff. She loves her aunt. She checks on her, and she's ready to blow the whole house to smithereens, to hell. We do that with each other. Because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax. It did not say a few. It uses the word rab. Many and abundance shall wax cold. They don't have love. They are not sincere. They are loquacious to talk about nothing. It's almost like me trying to show us the way of Yah, and I'm a damn hypocrite. Trying to show you the ways of Yah that is Sadiq, and I'm living a life that is full of duplicity, falsehood, a damn hypocrite. That's what it's like. It's almost like a fat man trying to tell someone how to lose weight. It's almost like someone on the Atkinson diet. They weigh 320 pounds, they've lost 10 pounds, and now they got the world by the handle. Oh, people do it all the time. It's just the truth. It's almost like someone that is so unhealthy, you see it in the pores of the skin, they walk up, and they're trying to tell you how to get healthy. It is such duplicity, Yisra'iyah. I will be a wise man, be quiet, and wait till I get myself to that degree, Ish or Isha, and then I will strengthen my ox hand. Just like me, a man that wants to watch and listen to this pornography and every kind of filthy, these old stupid women. Matter of fact, Mr. Pat Robertson, this man of God, and he is Mr. Pat Robertson, is a mighty, mighty, mighty man of God. Pat Robertson of CBN is a mighty, mighty man of God. Pat Robertson is one of the most mightiest man of God. Pat Robertson is a mighty apostle of Jesus Christ. He is one of Jesus Christ's mouthpiece. He is the one sent forth by God. I heard him the other day. Two things he said with Mr. Petraeus. The name sounds just like what he is. He is a betrayer, isn't it? Mr. Petraeus. This dirty bastard, this dog, this Puritan, like they're so clean. And he's a dirty, adulterous bastard. You understand? No discreet about his actions. Mr. Petraeus. Petraeus, he is a betrayer. You understand? And he betrayed the one that had confidence in him, Mr. Barack Hussein Obama. You understand? So that's why they're doing everything in secret in their closed doors. They're closing their doors. But Mr. Pat Robertson, the mighty, mighty man of God. So all of you that are worshiping God, you are under the authority of Pat Robertson, whether you bow or not. You Hebrews that call yourself God and Lord in Jesus, Pat Robertson is the Hebrew of Hebrews. He is the man of God. He has a voice like no other Hebrew. He extended his broadcast all over the world. He is a man of God. He said that what Mr. Petraeus did, I don't see nothing wrong with it. He is a man. And she was a nice looking woman. What do you expect? She runs marathons. She's strong. She's fit. And his wife did look quite homely. I saw her. I said, oh, wow, this is what you think of your wife, man. She was a homely looking woman. She really did. And then he also says, not only that with Mr. Petraeus, but he brought out, he said, he didn't realize that that women watch more pornography. They watch it as much as men. You got to be a sick damn creature to watch men, and you are sick in your damn mind. You are a stupid beast. You are a sick damn thing. You are sick. I don't care who you get excited over that. I mean, that's something twisted there. Something is not right here. You want to watch another man? That's stupid. I mean, to me, I couldn't do that. I wouldn't even do, man, look at that stupid looking woman. Her head look as though that it is out of E.T., some contorted, and these filthy whores. Why would that excite one? And those that are spending the money on that are women, and the toys, that's who's spending the money. It's just the truth. Statistics shows it. It's just the truth. And the men, what they call men, they're faggots. They're faggots in the prison houses. They're making them fags. And you got the little boys that don't even have the strength of a man. I will, man. I'm not taking down, man. For no one. Mamas raise their boys to be just like them. No, the Torah says, as the mother, so is the daughter. But now, it's as the mama, so is the son. They're weak and effeminate. They're fag pump looking now. Do not the girls wear the tight jeans and you can see everything? So the boys are wearing the tightest now. Isn't that so? Now, give me something that's loose, man. Oh, this is going to hit home today. This is simple. I like this. I'm not changing one damn thing. Not a bit. I ain't changing nothing. So this is what he says about Mr. Petraeus. Well, you know, that's just, he's a man. Is that so? Pat Robertson is a man of God. Pat Robertson is a mighty man of the loud Jesus Christ. He is a master of the loud Jesus Christ. And everyone that calls on the name of the loud Jesus, everyone that calls on the name of the loud, everyone that calls on the name of the loud, you must submit unto Pat Robertson. Because they are beasts just like him. And that's the truth. Now, we don't want to deal with that. There are those who are, well, that has nothing to do with that. It has a tremendous application to do with us. It does. These liars talking about their traditions. What is the tradition of the slave drivers and the thieves of this nation and their virtue? What kind of damn virtue they have? Let's get real. Mr. Obama is going to take this wicked nation down the hill. Let him do it, y'all. You raise them up. Yet when Mr. Elijah Muhammad was calling for secession, they were talking about this radical, depraved people. He said, we have built this nation, our people, we are slaves. Give us some land and let us secede from you. And now that's all every state, the Republicans, this whiteness in this nation, they're calling for secession. But these are the same damn bastards say they love America. You might as well hear me. These are the same damn beasts. Mr. Elijah Muhammad was vilified. He was brought down. He was exposed to have four or five wives. They have babies everywhere. And these same damn beasts and bastards are pedophiles. And they do every kind of vile, unclean thing. We want to secede. We want Texas to secede. Since Mr. Obama has been elected, and anytime they get signature of 30,000 people or more, they must deal with that situation. Well, the state of Texas, they've gotten that. We are Texas and we love America. We got our flag, shirts on, and we're American first. God bless America. God loves America. God damn America. That's what Mr. Jeremiah Wright said. Mr. Obama dumped him like you dump a pair of dirty tennis shoes. I heard the man's speech. I heard what he said. He was talking about how the elitists and the rich, how they are robbing the poor and killing them, taking from them. He said, we are saying that God bless America. We ought to say God damn America for its wicked, vile ways. They vilified that man, tore him down and robbed him. Yet the senators can say we want secession. We want our own country because we don't want Mexicans around us. We don't want black folks around. That's what they're saying. They want to secede. They want secession. When Mr. Elijah Muhammad, and damn Mr. Elijah Muhammad, but when he brought up that in his message to those of the diaspora, he was vilified. He was confronted. They and Mr. Hoover and those boys brought everything they could out on him. They exposed him like you do a pair of dirty drawers. They vilified the man. But now you have these nations since Mr. Obama. There have been 13 nations, 13 countries in this nation. They are garnering the votes, the signatures of the petitions, and they're Republicans, what they call. And they want to secede. They want their own president. They want them a white president. They want them a white Senate. They want them a White House. That's why it's the White House is meant for a white mind. You all get all crazy all you want to. It makes me no difference. We live in a social society. We live in a society that we must confront all the ills that draw Yisrael, that we take sides with that damn mess. It is a damn lie. It is false. It is not real. It is not sincere. They say they love America, don't they? You pack of hypocrites sit here all cowardly and quiet. God bless America. We're Texans down here. We love God, country, and our guns, GDD. God, gut, and guns. God bless America. At least we got one sound. But they have love, just like we. Our love is just like this worldly love. It's not fervent. Because you cannot have love without your heart being nurtured by Torah. And our hearts are nurtured by greed. We love to eat and sleep. When you all love, Zeriah said, I heard you say last night, Papi, that we had gone and now we were home. I heard you say that. If you heard nothing else, she said that. She heard that. And so while you all were gone, Simeon and I, it'd be 12, 1, I guess 12 midnight, we go to bed because you're sitting up. And one morning I got up at 7:45. I said, what a lazy pig. But I was able to work and get things done. I got quite a bit done. And then there was one morning I did not get up until 8 a.m. I said, boy, you know that's flat out lazy. Yeah, I slept that late. 7:30, 8. And if I could have, I would have ate the whole time. But I knew it wasn't the best thing for me. I like me too much. And I like to sleep at night. And as I cannot be eating that time of the night. Cannot do it. Because that is the natural proclivity of the flesh. That's the natural desire. To eat, sleep, drink, and do nothing. That's why we must be led by the Ruach and not by the flesh, Yisrael. You show me one thing that your flesh leads you into that's productive. Well, you said you were working because I do all things as unto Almighty Yahweh. When I labor as unto Almighty Yahweh. My work is for Him. Everything I do with preciseness. I do it with care. I do it with attention to the smallest minute detail. I do it because I do everything as unto Him because I know He's watching. Even when I worked in the secular world, I say, Yah, everything in all of my ignorance, and I'm still ignorant, I did it as though that it was pleasing unto my King. I want you to see this. I'm not going to fluff, see what I can get by with, see what little I can do. I want to make sure. I want to take advantage, Yah. That's the way I do it. I don't do it half-heartedly. I don't care whether it's stacking woods, whether it's separating my wood squares. No, I don't need you to do that for me. I want to do that. Long as Yah gives me a back that bends and hands that will work. My Yeshua said to me, your hands are so fat and big. I said, I'm glad because I can grab hold to a maul or an axe. I can take the chainsaw and I can hear it to roar and do what I have to. I don't want little hands like yours. I need to grab hold and work. I don't want them soft like yours. Of course, I wear gloves and protect my hand. And I protect my eyes. That I do. Hallelujah. Let me move on here. I want to get to something here. It says that we have loved the brothers, seeing you have loved one another with a pure heart fervently, being born again, not of the corruptible seed, but of the seed that is incorruptible, which is the word of Yah. This is how we are birthed. We are born again. There is a revival, Yisrael. And it is the word of Yah, the Torah of Yah, to cause the life of Yah to bring forth the renewed birth. We are still humans, but there's a birth of liveliness that shall excel from us when we hear the Torah of Yah. It shall come forth. We're born again by the word of Yah. Well, I don't believe that. Well, there are people that have tremendous character. Tremendous changes in their lives by people counseling them. Oh, he was on drugs. He was running after the law. He had done that, and all of a sudden, he's a model citizen. He speaks to the young men. He takes time with them. She does this. She was on crack. She did that. She went to college, got an associate degree. She went back. I was raised with one like that. Her name is Judy. I saw her probably 20 years ago, 15 years ago. I saw Judy. And Judy was, she was not the most pristine woman in the day. If I may use the word hoe, she was a hoe. She was a loud mouth hoe. And I remember nearly 20 years ago when they began to do an article in the Observer on Judy. I remember reading it. She had gone to Central Pete Mount. She had gotten her associate degree. She goes from Central Pete Mount to UNC. She got her bachelor's degree, and then she worked to get her master's degree. And it was just, and when I saw Judy, we were talking. And at that time, she had this, she had, what had she purchased? She said, she was telling me how she had trucks. She had drivers, and she said that was one of my drivers I was just meeting with. So she had this driver. She had trucks that she ran all over the United States. And so she began to tell, she said, well, I got six season tickets. That's when the Hornets, the first Hornets were here, she said. She began to tell me about all that. She said, you know, I met with George Shinn and all those, and I met with the public relations. And that and the woman was a flat-out hoe. Babies out of wedlock. But to the masses of the media, she was a role model then. Although, forget all the past.
She's going to college. She's got a master's degree. She got the degrees. Maybe she's still with Judy to me. You understand what I'm saying? She still spoke the same. She still was silly as they come. She was still loud as Judy was. But yet in her life, there was a cataclysmic change in her life. And so she was born again. She was not the old Judy. She was another Judy. She was still Judy in the body, but her mind did not think like the old Judy. She was Judy in the presence of a physical being, but her actions and her activities were not like the old Judy. That is what born again is. What I was yesterday, I'm not that this hour. And what I was that hour, I'm not that the next hour. And what I was that hour, I'm not that the next minute. And what I was that minute, I'm not that the next second. We are born again by the power of Yah's word, that it comes into us, it penetrates us, and it changes the whole aspect of our lives, us, even our physical. Come on, the word of Yah changed us physically. We don't even look the same. No, I don't look like I used to look. We don't even look the same. That's what the word of Yah does. That's what the word of Yah does. When I see those that I went to school, I don't look like them. No, I don't look like them. Don't try to brush up on me. No, no, don't do that. I don't even look like them. I don't look like them. I don't look like them. I don't have the appearance in my eyes and my face. I don't look like them. I don't look like them. Period. No, don't brush up on me now. You forget that. Don't get close to me. Come on, girl. How are you doing? Had one to tell me, you're everything I thought you would be. I said, well, I'm nothing. You know that. No. I'm just being upfront and honest. She looks at me and she says, you're everything that I knew you would become. You thought I would become a preacher? No. That's not what I'm talking about. Mm-mm. I ain't talking no preacher talk. She said, you're everything I thought you would be. Everything. And she's grinning and looking at me like, this nasty heifer. And so I'm trying to change the subject. No, you're everything I thought you would be. You're just what I knew you would turn out to be. You that old, I'll let you figure it out, all right. She said, you're everything I thought you would be. Look at you. And I'm like, look at you. Mm-mm. You forget that. I'm not that desperate. I'm not that desperate. Never, Mama, I've been that desperate. Never, Mama. Over 35 years, never been desperate. Never had any needs of anything else. It is right, son. I'm not afraid to say it. Hallelujah. We be born again, not a corruptible seed, but of the incorruptible Zira, the word of Yah, which lives and abides forever. And he lets us know that all flesh is as grass, and all the honor and esteem of man is as the flowers of grass. The grass withers away, and the flower thereof falleth. But he gives us a great assurance, but the Torah, the word of Yah, endureth forever. I don't care what your trials, what the heaven is, you got something that endures forever. You got truth. And I want to give us an example of that truth before I close it today, all right? Hallelujah. I really wanted Zakein Yarameyah to preach today, but I knew he was tired. He knows that he has the free reign. He has the free reign of the broadcast. I wish he would take that overtime, because when I'm free to wait and preach on that Shabbat, as Akmikaya, he wrote to me last night, don't blow yourself out now. I need you in the morning. I'd rather you just go off tonight and be ready in the morning. You understand? Because there's a different conveying of Yah's truth. So he knows that he has whomever he wants to take on the broadcast. I have no compunction with that. You understand? We're labors together. Hallelujah. It says, for all flesh is as grass, and the honor of men as the flowers of grass, and the grass withers, so the flower there fall. But the Torah of Yah endures forever. And this is the word, which by the Bezorach, the teaching, is preached unto you. And that's what Yah preaches unto us. That's what he teaches unto us. We must know the truth, Yisra'iyah. It is the truth that calls and develops love in us.
And if we don't understand what truth is, we will not be developed in the love of God. That's why we are so dysfunctional. As we're so twisted, our actions, our activities. And that's why Nahash has his power to reign in our bosom. And we don't realize that.
Again, Tehillim 119. I want to read this. I know I've read it before. Hallelujah. I want to read this quickly. And take my time. It says in Tehillim 119, verse 137. It says to Yah that Sadiq, you are O Yahweh. He is. And he is Yosha. He is upright. Yosha. It's a straightness. He is straight. In our days, as Zachain Shimri, that he knows that he's no older than me. When one was right by you, say, you're straight, man. I know you're straight. That's the way we talk. When you're saying you're straight, you knew that they were right. You knew that they weren't going to do you wrong. I don't care how corrupt they were. You knew that they would do you right. You would say, you're straight, man. I know you're straight. And they would say, man, oh, Earl, he's straight, man. You know he's straight. You know he's going to do you right. And so that's what the word Yosha is, that Yah is straight. He is Sadiq. His character, there is no holes in his character at all. So he is righteous, he is. And he is upright. And upright is his mishpatim, or his mishpat. The judgment of Yah is right. When Yah judges, his right, Yisrael, he judges us because he loves us. Tell me what parent doesn't correct the child if they love them. Doesn't mean they abuse them. They correct them with the rod. Even sometime before time, they do enough of that. They say, that's enough. So they correct them because they understand the process of the future, what it will produce. They understand that, Yisrael. So he is right. And also in the next verse, it says that his edah, his testimony, his mighty works, your testimonies, thy testimonies that you have commanded or savah, you have the authority to speak it, they are sadiqa. And they are very faithful. They are full of emunah. If we read the testimonies of Yah, what is more greater than the testimony of Yahshua HaMashiach? It is very righteous. It is very faithful. And it worked for us, Yisrael. That's why the spirit of Nahash was to rid our minds of the power of that testimony. Because when Yahshua is revealed, it brings about the rejoicing of assurance in our bosom. And we know that Yah is on our side. And so the enemy keep our minds moved away from that. We can't allow that. Now we said, my zeal, my desire, my passion has consumed me. Because my enemies, they have forgotten your word. When one forgets the word of Yah, that's an enemy of Yisrael. I don't care who it is, our son, daughters, when they forget Yah's word, he said they have forgotten the word of Yah. They are my enemies because I stand strong. And when you stand in the Sadiq of Yah, the enemy will rise up to destroy you and to try to discourage you, Yisrael. That's why we have to have a fervent love for each other. To be honest, say, no, you don't do that. It's wrong. You said, what? Hold on. You don't get by with that. Not with me. No. You said that? Don't ever say that, man. You're wrong, young brother. Elderly brother, you're wrong. Your ways are not right, man. You don't see that? Well, tell me what I'm doing wrong. I just told you what you're doing wrong. You're wicked. Poppy, you are wicked. Abner's wicked. And I am wicked. So you're wicked, man. How about that? But you call me wicked, but you ain't telling me because you're a criminal. You flat-out liar. Take that now. All right. Nobody wants to be honest. In the days, they would say, girl, that little girl is a heifer hoe. She ain't nothing but a liar. That boy lied to your face. Boy, you a liar. They would say it just like that. They didn't cut no corners. You lied on them. Mama, she made me do it. Nah, little heifer, you did that. I was sitting here watching. She's a little liar. She did it. It's not that, mama, listen, baby, it wasn't him. It was that little knucklehead heifer. She did it. Thank you, Miss Cutting Coran. That's how they would say. Thank you, ma'am. Miss B, thank you so much. Come on in here, boy.
You lied to me. He said that thy word is very tahor. It is pure. There's nothing to taint the word of Yah. That's why when we hide it in our heart, that we sin not against him, because his word is very pure. He said, therefore, your abbots, those that are faithful and labor in Torah, those that are sincere, they love it. They have a great passion. Are we servants of Yah? If we're servants of Yah, we love the purity of his word. We love. Hold that there. I want to read this again back, what I just read. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He says here, as I read, hallelujah. Here's what I want to read again. Greet you all that have joined us. I know that this order has gone in a way that you did not perceive, but God's dealing with you, all right? Hallelujah. And so that's all that matters. It's not what it sounds like. It's whether it deals with your heart. Hallelujah. Yes. Yahweh, that's one scripture that so profoundly stood in my mind when I read that here in this book. I'm trying to find it quickly. Hallelujah. We cannot go around this Torah of Yah. There is no way we're going to get around it. And there's no way we're going to obfuscate or to refuse to obey that all that Yah commands us to do. And if we think that's the case, we have fooled ourselves, and woe unto us, Yisrael. We must obey. We must hear all that he commands us, and we must do all that Yah commands us to do. Hallelujah. Here's what it says right here. I want to read this. It says, seeing you have purified your nephesh by obeying the truth. Did not he say that your word is very pure? And we're talking about the truth now. Kephas say, seeing your eye in your spiritual perception, your mental, your spiritual wisdom of the matter, you have made your tahor to make clean, to have it ceremoniously presentable unto Yah, that you can offer unto Yah the offerings that he will receive. It must be a pure offering from a pure heart. You cannot bring something that has spots or blemishes. You cannot come before Yah with blemishes of wickedness and all in our bosom and expect them to receive the offering of our hands. So we purify ourselves by how? By the judgment, by the testimony of Yah, and by Yah's judgment. He judges, correct me, Yah, in thy judgment and not in thy anger, lest you cause me to be brought down to the gates of hell. And this is how we purify ourselves, by obeying. Purified ourselves by obeying the truth. That we said that your Torah, your word is very pure. Your Daba, your promises, they are very tahor, they are pure. They are set aside, they are pristine. There is nothing in it that is tainted. Was Yahshua the word of Yah made flesh? Was he tainted in any way? Was there sin found in him? Yet he sinned not. He was not tainted, Yisrael. We are the sons of Yah. We have been begotten before the four foundations of the earth by the foreknowledge of Yah, just like the foreknowledge of his word, that Yahshua will redeem us from all of the vile mess that we had created through the spirit of Nahash, through this bewitching demon power that speaks to your mind. You obey it, you follow pursuit, you pursue what it commands you, endure with and an august spirit. It's wrong, Israel. We have purified ourselves by obeying the truth. His word is very pure. Therefore, the abbot, the servants, those that labor for the cause of Yah, there's a great love for it. And if we love Yah, he says, ach, love the brothers. We must love the ach. We must love the ach. And the love of the ach is not grinning and skinning. It is the power of one's heart revealed. It is the sincerity of one's heart. That is love, not some damn grinning and skinning and folly. That's not love. We have pure love for each other. He says in Tehillim 19:14, he said, I'm small. I like that die. He was the king, wasn't he? We're nothing without Yah. He said, I am small and despised. He says, yet I do not forget your pikkud, your precepts, your limitations, your ordinance, what you have commanded. I don't forget that. See, we don't forget his truth. We don't forget the precepts of his love toward Yisrael. We don't allow Nachash, Lachavash, you allow the spirit of Nachash to remove us. And next week, Yah's will, I will get to this teaching. It takes energy to teach this. All right, Yisrael, you just can't get up and teach this. I don't care. That's why men, they get up and they talk and they just fuddle around and they just read scripture after scripture and there's no explanation, no explaining. There's no tying in to the whole, all right? And I want to tie it in. This will be nourishment for us today, all right? This is what we need to do. We get our minds pure, and we do that by obeying. We hear the Torah of Yah. We don't harden our hearts like in the days when they provoke Yah. You don't harden your heart. You don't say, that's not me. Poppy, you are wicked. Abner is wicked, and I am wicked. Thank you, little girl. Give me a hug. That's what I said. If Sarah hears us and she says, oh, I'm going to tell mommy. No, I don't want you to tell that. I'll tell that because I like what she said. Hallelujah. Papi, you are wicked. And I'm just wicked. And I am wicked. Hallelujah. I'm glad they're not wicked. Because they don't know the activities of being criminals. We have learned criminal activities and we'll criminals against Yah. The word Rasha is guilty of sin. You're guilty. And there is no redemption. It is only by the dam of Yahshua HaMashiach that blood speaks. Then why will we impel him afresh? We know we are wrong. Why will we go and do it again? You know you're wrong. Why would you perform the same sin and the same corruption? Something is not right in your damn mind, Yisrael. You're sick. You're a creature. I'm small and I'm despised, but I've not forgotten your pikkud. Your tzedakah is an olam v'am. Your righteousness, it never ceases. Your character, your characteristics, they never cease. He says, and your law, your Torah is the truth. Again, Kepha says, he said, your Torah is the truth. He says, seeing you have purified your nefesh in obeying the truth. Does it say that? It says obeying the truth. Does it say that in Tehillim 119:142 that his Torah is the truth? So we must obey the Torah. We got the self-righteousness among men by traditions. You got those they call themselves brews that they wear dreadlocks. And the ones they have their hair plaited down, which is a lie before Almighty Yah. Because some Sunni had seven locks and they got all kind of dirty little old twisted locks on their heads. He didn't have no 30 locks or one big old lock. He had seven. And then when he touched the unclean things, it was shaved off, Yisrael. And when a man wanted to be a Nazarene, he grew his hair. And for a moment when he touched that which was unclean, it was not a sustained thing. We are Nazarites. In Yahshua, we are pure. And the unclean things don't touch us in this damn stupid generation. So the ones that wear plaits, they're vilified by the ones that wear dreads. So God didn't tell you to wear no plaits. They call themselves damn Hebrews. They false. That's what they bicker about. Where's your belt? And cats with bellies like that. There are those that wear Sikhs and those that if they don't wear the belt, they're wrong. So that's stupid. I have on the belt. My loins are good about with truth. And it certainly isn't gutted about with a row of fat like that. Like a fat hog. Don't look like that. You will be surprised what's out there. Sure it is. Let me move on, Yisrael. So it's not that I'm one that is hiding. I want them to know. And I challenge the doctrines of lies. I challenge them. They take the young men. They're coming out of prison. They're what we call the hood, the ghettos. And they're spewing these lies in their mind. We're going to find out what are the curses. If those that are supposed to be the Hebrews here, the dark-skinned people, are their curse, it is the same damn doctrine that the white man put on them, saying that they were the Hamites. And there are those that say, well, we are the Shemites. We're not. And they denounce Ham. And yet the Cushites come out of Ham. And Moshe married a woman that was a Cushi. This is how stupid they are. And so they vilify those that are the same hue of skin there in Africa. And the ones that are white, they will say, well, all of our brothers in Europe, in Canada, in America, in Sweden, in Finland, if you're white, then you're Hebrew. It's the same thing. You can sit here or we can listen and cringe on that. Damn the white Hebrew doctrine. Damn the black. Damn the Mexicans. Their damn doctrines. I'm not afraid to say that. And so what they do, they bring these disciples in and they all go say the same thing. They don't know what they're saying. They just say it because they've heard it. Just like what she said, you're wicked, puppy, because she hear me say you're wicked. And you're wicked. So she repeated that. They have no wisdom of it at all. And they take scriptures and twat it. Well, he said, I'm black like Eo. But what that is, that doesn't mean. It means just like someone said, I'm pink and blue. That's not what the word kata means. And they take words and twist it. And we want to look at Yahshua if his feet were brown like copper. Well, then there are people that are more, he is more brown or more copper-like than he is. He doesn't look copper-like. Her skin is more copper-like than his skin. His skin ain't copper-like. Can't go around. You all wake them up, tell them, Re'ach, thy weed is here. And tell them they want to come challenge me. First thing we're going to do, we're going to run 3 miles. We're going to jog 3 miles. Got a 250-pound sled. They push that. These big fat ones can't even do that. And then we go from there. Then we have a long, nice day's work. We sit down and eat a wonderful meal. Tell me what you want to eat. We don't fry no pork chops here. We'll fry you some lamb chops. Hallelujah. We don't have no pork ribs here. We will do some nice beef ribs. We don't have no pork sausage here. We do some deer sausage. Appreciate that ark for bringing meals home for us, all right. You all hear that? I appreciate my aunt, Yusipia, he brought the meal home, all right. You're the last one to get something. You are? Okay. He brought the meal home. We got some for you, all right. Beautiful big old deer. Big. Nice rack on it. You only threw the head away, did you? You only buried that head. Man, take that head off and set it in an ant pile. And I like to keep them racks. You see, when you get it out, don't throw them. Nice racks. Fat little thing it was. I looked at us, thought about you. Oh, got him some of this deer. I know he likes to roast deer. We appreciate that, my aunt. All right. Yeah, brah. His riches rest upon you. And all the other lock as well, too. All right. He says here quickly, I want to close. He says in verse 143, he says, Sarah, trouble and anguish have taken hold of me. Who don't have trouble and anguish? He said, trouble and anguish have taken hold of me. He said, yet your mitzvah are my hafetz. Although all you're going through, let us walk in the commandments of Yah. Let us do what the commands say. Here is a king that has servants and his house obeys him. They're willing, they love him to obey him. And yet he says there is Sarah, there's deep conflict, there are deep battles and anguish. He said, but through all of that, I know your commandments are true. And I love him. I want to hear that, not folly. You ought to want to hear the commandments of Yah. He said, but I love them. I love them. I love your, I delight in your commandments. He said, your Sadiqah. He said, the righteousness of your testimony, your eduth is everlasting. And then he says unto Yah, Nathan. He used that little word, Nathan, bestow, grant. That's what Nathan is, grant, bestow, permit it to be. He says, grant to me, be not. I want to be able to discern, grant to me that, Yah. He asked Yah for that. He said, if you give me that, I shall live. Hayi, 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 not hayya, but hayi. It is a life that celebrates the bountifulness of Yah. It is a life of dancing and singing. That's what it is. He said, give me that and I shall live. Then he tells Yah, I cried, I kara, I made a sound. I cried with kol, my whole love, my whole heart. And he asked Yah to shemach, hear me, oh Yah, hear my cry. He says, and I will keep your statutes, your hukah. I will keep them. I will guard them. I have failed Yah, but I will guard your truth. I will guard your statutes. He said, I cried unto you. He says, Yeshua, or say me. He said, and I shall keep your eruth, your testimonies. I shall guard them. I shall be preserved in your testimony. I shall keep them in my mind. I shall speak of the mighty power of your testimonies, O Yah. He says, I prevented the dawning of the morning. And I cried. He said, I didn't even see when the morning arose because I was crying. My eyes were so full of great rejoicing of your abundance. He said, and I take on my hope of promise is in his word. That's the only place, Yisrael. I don't care what Mr. Barack Obama does. He give away all the gifts he can, but the gift and the eternal gift of life is only through Yeshua HaMashiach. I don't care what they give away, Yisrael. It's amazing that Mr. Ryan Paul said that Mr. Obama, he won because of the urban vote. Well, that's a lie. He won places like New Hampshire. He won places like Vermont. That's just pure white rural vote. This is how they play on the minds of the people. And people buy that. Well, our country's going to hell. It was already full of hell. They blame this wealthy contractor's death on Mr. Obama. He killed himself. He killed his wife. I saw his family had an attractive family. His son was young, vivacious. He killed a 16-year-old boy, killed about a 9-year-old boy. His wife was a very vibrant woman. He was not a poor contractor. He was an arms dealer. He was a wealthy contractor. So he killed himself. He killed his wife. He killed his sons. I know his sons would rather kick his backside if they could get up. You coward bastard. Kill yourself. Leave the money to your son. He'll be all right. He doesn't mind Obama taking a little more taxes because he's alive. This bastard killed his sons, killed his wife, and then the coward jackass killed himself. Kill your damn self, bastard. And they kept expressing he was a wealthy contractor, arms dealer. They kept expressing he was a wealthy contractor. Y'all don't remember that? I get enough papers around here to remember that. He was a wealthy contractor. And he said he didn't want his children to incur the debt of Mr. Obama. You wealthy pig. I don't sympathize with a man like that. You kill your baby because you're afraid to pay, instead of paying 72 cents, you got to pay 76 cents. You are a pig and you're wealthy. You're wealthy and you kill your babies. Oh, he was a loving father. He was a damn fool. He was not even a beast. Even when male lions fight, they don't fight to kill each other. They just want the pride. Move on. You just run. You will have no problem with me. But if you want to try to hold on to this harem, we go to battle, baby. The big lion get up and run. He has no more problem. He may chase him a while and say, get on. I don't want to run you far enough where I don't see you no more. And that's it. Even animals don't do that. And this fool killed his babies, his wife, his two sons that he loved. Because Mr. Obama hasn't caused one damn thing on this nation. This nation was running a Ponzi scheme from day one. It's been built upon a Ponzi scheme. It has robbed and stolen. He is just a puppet place put in place to diffuse the attention of the real dogs and the real bastards. So you can vent your aggressiveness against him. And there's a black man in the White House. So we want secession. We want our own land. We want our own country. But we still love America. Stupid beast. This bomb is not going to affect the lives of the Hebrews one bit at all. If anything, just like the Pharaoh with Moshe, that Pharaoh, he said, no, we're not letting them. Cause them to work even harder. Y'all said, that's what I want. Because I know I'm going to hear their cries now. He heard their cries because of the taskmaster. He said, cry, baby. Oh, that's what I want to hear. Come on, cry to me. Oh, come on. He heard the cries because of the oppression of the taskmaster. And he says, Moshe, go down. My people, it's time to bring them out. Go down. He told Abraham 400 years, but it was 430 years. On the day of the 430th year, he brought them out. He's going to bring Israel out, that's scattered throughout the nations of the world under the systems of bondage, that the spirit of Nahash captivate their minds and destroy them. This Obama has not caused our tyranny, caused our agony, our pain. This Obama did not start the war in Iraq. Mr. Obama did not start that intrusion there in Afghanistan. It was there when it got there. Even a person in debt with 5 or 6 credit cards or 10 of them and they're all maxed out, it's going to take more than 3 years to pay them out. It is the truth, man. With a meagerly salary and they think they're going to pay them out in a year, it's not going to happen. He needs to turn our country around. Why did he tell Mr. Bush that? Let's be real, Yisrael. These folks are phony. Mr. Bush didn't do me no damage. Neither will Mr. Obama. Mr. Clinton didn't do me no damage. He was Yah's man. He showed the nature of this country by doing what he did in the big White House. You think he's the only one done something like that in the White House? There have been faggots and everything in there. The fags and every kind of vile thing has taken place in the White House. You know, something to do with slavery that the slave owners... their wives will allow them to have a nigger bitch, what they will call them. It's just the truth. They will allow the nigger to be the bedwoman. They will call them a nigger bitch. Now that's just the truth. And she was the bedwoman of this old cranky white man, having no virility, no energy. She will warm his bed and make sure that she supplied what he needed. And that was common here in the South and the North. You understand? That was a common practice. And so that's why you got this population of the little mulatto young'uns. Look at that boy there. Come on. They were mulattoes, what they say. We don't want to deal with that. We want to hide it. Just like our sins, we don't want to reveal our sins. We must confess it. America must confess their sins and their wickedness. And they're not going to do it because their pride won't allow them to do it. And we get caught up in the white thing or the black thing. And that's where we lose it. I'm caught up in Yeshua's thing. I'm caught up in the things of Yah. I'm caught up in the Torah thing. Hell, white people kill white people. Black people kill black people. You think that you know how many people are dying in China daily by murder and killing and robbing and drug and gang banging? You think that doesn't happen? It's silly. They got 1.67 billion people. Chinese kill Chinese. It's not the Crips and Bloods from LA walking down there in Mexico and gunning them down and massacres 20, 30 at a time. It's Mexican kills Mexicans. White people kill white people. I was looking this morning whereby they found in the lake right down here, I can look at names almost and tell who it is, that they found 2 bodies in 2 barrels in the lake down here in South Carolina. One had died sometime recently and the other one, ain't no telling how long he had been dead. And it was used a machete and a chainsaw to cut him up. There ain't too many people having chainsaws, all right? Even poor Negroes in the country don't have chainsaws. They don't buy them. That's the truth. And cut the man's body up. So white people kill white people. White on white crime. You got black people that kill black people. Black on black crime. You got those on the reservation, Indians. Indians kill Indians. Indian on Indian crime. You got mafia. You got Italian on Italian crime. You got Hutu on Hutu crime. It is the truth. You got Chinese on Chinese crime. I saw a clip one time where this Chinese had this. It frightened me. I said, ooh. He had this woman hostage. He said that, you know, he's talking, he's going to kill him. The police, they run me. Turn her loose, turn her loose. And the sharp shooter was up. Oh, the sharp shooter was there. And you could see it. And the boy just moved 1 second this way. And it took his whole head off. Boom. And he didn't move a step. Scary. Shot his head off. That was not a white boy shooting his head off. That was a Chinese man shot his head off. You got Filipinas on Filipinas crime. Arabic on Arabic crime. Iranians kill Iranians. Egypts kill Egyptians. But it's a big fuss when it's Negro on Negro crime, isn't it? That's the only one that is acknowledged that way. Tell the truth, Yisrael. No other crime. You never hear white on white crime. You don't hear that down in Mexico, Mexican on Mexican crime. You hear cartel. That's all you hear. This is the only people that you find that it is identified black on black crime. Mexican here in America, they kill Mexicans. They don't hardly mess with too many people of color. Black boys kill black boys, and white boys, believe me, they kill too. Hallelujah. They trick the minds of the people percentage-wise. They love to use percentages. I want to close here momentarily. He says in verse 148, my eyes prevented the night watch, and I might meditate in your word. 149. He said, hear my voice according unto your love kindness, O Yah. And he says, make me alive according to your judgment. Don't you know that this is how he makes us alive? Why we fight judgment so much? Tell me. He said, make me alive. Cause me to live according to your judgment. Why we detest that? Because we do not lehag, we do not study, we do not meditate, we do not allow the Torah to fill our minds. He said, make me alive according to your judgment. When you judge, you ought to come alive. First thing we do, we get disgruntled and angry. Don't judge me. Well, you think when a mother corrects a child or the avatar, they see how they're acting? They can never see how they're acting. How do you know? But you go back to your days. I do nothing wrong. I don't see why you with me. I ain't do nothing wrong, mama. But boy, if you don't get that look off your face, well, ain't nothing wrong with my face. She knew it, didn't she? Don't tell me they didn't know it. Boy, don't call me a liar. I see what's in your eyes there, boy. They knew that. I do nothing wrong. Yes, you did. Boy, you little devil, you look at me like that, I bust your head. That's what they will tell us. You tell someone, what's wrong with your heart, huh? Come on, sister, what's wrong with you? Ain't nothing wrong with me. It's all in your expression. I can see it. And we don't think that that's us, but it's someone else. Come on, Yisrael. He makes us alive according to his judgment. So we should love his judgment. He quickened us according to his judgment. He said, those that fall after me, they draw close unto me, and they're full of wickedness, full of mischief. They are far from your Torah. When those that pursue the Sadiq or the righteousness among Yisrael, they are those that are far from his Torah. When those that engage with you in their conversation is nothing but folly, you know their minds are far from the Torah. When they want to talk silly talk, foolish talk, folly talk, you know their minds are far from the Torah. And they're your enemies, whether you buy it or not. He said, you are near, O Yah, and all your commandments are truth. It is Imat. All the commandments, everything he commanded, the whole book is a book of commandment. And they all are true. How many have you broken? So, well, you're not wearing this. You don't have on your belt, man. You ain't right. You fat belly beast. And it's always the big belly pigs that write me. That's what it's just the truth. No, I'm not talking about a man. Come on, we all got a little too much on us. I'm talking about hogs like that. That's what I'm talking about. We're talking about, you got a little gut. That's all right, man. We're getting old. We should have a little gut. We got that, so what? I'm talking about men like this. Big old hogs. As Tommy Jones would say, a hog. Big old hog. A hog. Slabs of port rind on their bellies. Come on. That's all right. He said, concerning your testimonies, I have known of old that they have been founded, or you have founded them forever and ever. And then he says this, consider my affliction and deliver me, for I do not forget your Torah. See, that's it. He will consider our affliction. And he has. That's why the Sarah that we're going to encounter, because of Nahash. He's not going to forget us. He hasn't forgotten us. Consider what we, maybe the affliction of the soul, he isn't, but he delivers us out of them all. Consider my affliction, Yah, and deliver me. And he said, I will not forget your Torah. He said, plead my cause and deliver me. He said, quicken me according to your word, or your promises. You said you would do it. He said, salvation or Yeshua is far from the wicked. Those that are the Rasha, Yeshua, his name, the conscience of Yeshua is far from them, for they seek not your statutes, your ordinance. They don't seek that. Great are your tender mercies, O Yah. Quicken me according to your judgment. He's going to make us alive according to his judgment. His mercies are great. And he's going to cause us to be alive according to his judgment. And so when he judges us, then we bow and shout hallelujah. We don't become so disdained with his judgment or the Musa of Yah. It was one thing as a child, my grandmother, my mother, if they told you something this the way you are, you didn't, as they would say, don't talk back, boy. You just received that. And then when you got quiet and sat down and considered, you will see how you are. There were many times as a child, I would always, when my mother would tell me things and when she would correct me, I would always go and sit by myself. I would cry or whatever, but then I would ponder what she said and just think about it. I said, this is real. And so what I would do, I always try to make amends, clean the house, do things. I would always do that, Mama. That's the truth. That's why I would do it. But I would watch my other brothers and my sister. They went, no, you, that ain't me. No, I didn't say that to my mother. I never said that. I was 17 years old when I left my mother's house. That's the last whipping I got. Come on, who in here at 17 were getting whippings at 17? I was getting whippings. And I was a man. No, I was a, come on, I was an athlete in school and this woman whipping me. And what happened when she started beating me? I just started walking up the steps. And then she says, you're too grown now. I can't whip you no more. Because all they got to do is just walk away from you. And I just turned around and looked at her. I didn't say, you're not going to. I would never say that to my mother. I never say, you're wrong. You're wrong for whipping me. I never said that. Never. Never. And that's the way we are. When someone says something, oh, you're so wrong. Because they don't want to see they're wrong. That's, aren't we like that? We're that way. Because we don't see our wrong. It's one thing in my house, I don't let my issue. If I say something, that's it. You're not going to tell me, you're not going to tell me where I'm wrong. I'm not going to let her do that. I'm not going to let her get that spirit in her that she thinks she's going to do that. Because you just hear what I say and do what I said, I will love you tenderly and kind and I'll be sweet to you. Women don't understand if you just hear and just obey and just do it. Huh? Instead of being brass with their mouths. That's all they got to do. If you got a real man, that's all you got to do. If you got a boy, it's a different ball game. You got a man, he'll do right by you. He'll do right by you. You learn how to be quiet, you'll realize that he would do kind things for you. That's just the truth. It's when you talk and when you're trying to convince and show your strength. It's one thing about a man, when another man want to hook up with him, he say, all right, boy, we going to dance tonight. You and me, let's dance. Huh? You may whip me, but I tell you what, you're going to know you've been in it. Huh? And you're going to know you've been in it. And you all hook up, as we would say in the days, you lock horns. He may whip the fight of you, but he knows that he got by the skin of his teeth. And he doesn't want to try that again. And you know you put it up on him. And he knows that. He may have wanted, nah, he ain't win. Boy, Shimon, he whipped the fire to him, man. Nah, he ain't win. Nah, boy. He dusts him up real nice. And he won't, yeah, boy, you want some more of me, baby? You want some more? Come on. He know he doesn't want no more. He walk, yeah, I want some more. He come in. Nah, man, come on. He glad that, no. He just, no, come on, man. I'm going to want you, baby. And he ain't no pressure on him now, but he knows that. He just, come on, man, nah. No, let me by, man. No, you don't want to get by. You know that. You ain't trying to get by. You know that. You glad he got his hand up like that. Come on, dog. Come on, man. No, come on, man. No, man, he ain't mad with me. I'll put something on him. No, he put something on you. You don't want to get past it. Just say, man, you whipped the fire to me. You did me right. You dust me real nice, and you took care of me. Everything is all right? Yeah, man, come on. Honest like that, man, I said, come on, let's go. Let's go to Chicken Go-Go's and get some.
get some fried chicken and bologna meat sandwich back in the day. Come on, let's go get some bologna meat. Huh? And a fish sandwich. Not no sandwich, but a sandwich. Huh? Get your fish sandwich and some fish fries. You spend $2, dollar and a half, and both of y'all sit there and eat. And then you become, as they would say, you become tight. Sure. Y'all's the one to fight our battle for us. We can't win. You're not going to win your way. You haven't won anything anyway. Look at our condition. We haven't won. May y'all bless us all. May you strengthen. You all, Yisrael, there will be times that I will break the order of my teaching because I know there are things that are vitally important that we need to hear. So we bless you all that have joined us, you that have been with us live on this broadcast. Do assist and help. Send an offering today. We have enough of you all. If you send $25 apiece, it will be a great blessing. Now, we're not beggars. My friend, if you're listening, if you hear this, send an offering. You didn't bring anything, so send an offering if you want to send something. You all that's listening, send an offering. You know, there are people that send offerings that I write them and they never respond, but they're faithful that way. They're faithful that way. There's a brother named Kevin. He sends offering all the time. I don't care how you respond. I say, come see me, my aunt. He never said anything. There's a brother named, we had a Kevin here, didn't we? Then there's a brother named Jeff. Did we have a Jeff here too? Okay. And there's a brother Jeff. He owns this. I don't know if brother Jeff is a health foods. I went to his website one time. It's a health food distribution, but he sends offerings. Probably listening now, but they always send off all the time. I don't care how many times we got an ark that we stroll. He sent $100 the other day. He always, I can write him 1,000 times and never respond. It's just the truth. But I know that they are there. I bless you all for your kindness, your gifts. Do send an offering. You all know we don't beg here, but send something. Don't let Walmart take it all. They're already billionaires. They don't need another penny. But they're not looking for another million now. They're looking for another penny. They know the pennies add up. And the more pennies you spend, I hate Walmart. I don't even like going there. I go there maybe once every 2 weeks. I don't even like going to Walmart. I prefer going to Target's if I wanted to get something that's even got some decency. I hate Walmart. I don't go there. I don't like going to Walmart. I don't like Walmart. I don't even like the spirit of it. I don't like the way they treat the people. I don't like it. And I try not to spend one dime in Walmart. I remember as a young cat in Dalton Village, it was this Jewish man. He owned this store. And everybody went to that. They call him Mr. Ord. I didn't go to the bastard store because I knew that he was messing with your little young black prostitutes. I know. There was one by the name Brent Brown. Come on, I know what I'm saying. Do you understand? But here, this Jew bastard, that's what he was. And I say it that way with his stuff right. His wife was an arrogant Jezebel. She would come in there with diamonds and diamond rings. And she would deal with the customer. I said, I wouldn't spend a dime with this bastard. I will walk 10 miles before. And I did not. Not me. And I watched the way she would treat the people with disdain as though they were dogs. And they would say, Miss, how you doing? She didn't even want to speak to them. I said, this filthy whore, you won't get my money. Not mine. Mother, take me up the oars. I'm not taking the oars. I take you up to the other little store. I'm not taking you there. And this rich bastard, he made his money just in the among the people of the diaspora, and he treated them, and he had them crazy Negroes, and then they would kill you dead. Nobody robbed him. He had enough boys, and then they were packing strong too. And when he would come out at night, I recall looking when he would come out at night, it would be like Fort Knox out there. They guard that store, guard him, pump shots. And everybody, old Bubba worked there too. Old Bubba, he walking there like he's out there in the military. Like he's in jungle patrol. And you have them all around him. And he would jump in his fine automobile. And he was touching those little prostitutes. Believe me, I know what I'm saying. He was a dirty bastard. That's what he was. And he would rob those people, charge them to cash their money. I wouldn't give the pig a penny. If I was thirsty and dying, I wasn't going to give him a penny. Not me. He wasn't going to get one dime from me. And I didn't go and darken the doors of that nasty place. I did not get my money. Negroes let him treat you like that. Mr. Orr's damn Orr.
He's dead and in hell. You're so judgmental. No, I know that wicked man is in hell. And that's a fact. Hallelujah. He did the people wrong. He did them wrong. I know what I'm saying. But he will not get my money. See, I'm not spending my money with this beast. I drive to the store across town before I spend a penny with him. And I did not do it. May Yah bless you. Oh, as I said, send an offering you that. Send an offering if you were not blessed today. You go to Walmart to spend money and you say, why did I buy that? And you're too afraid to take it back. You're too afraid to take it back. I threw away the receipts. They ain't going to take it. I can't take it back. So instead of spending money at Walmart, don't wait for Black Friday. Your day is black today. Send an offering. Don't let them suck your money. I get all this mail, Black Friday, but what a day they call it, Black Friday. You would think you would call it White Friday or Bright Friday. They call it Black Friday. People are too dumb. I won't spend a nickel, especially on that day. I don't care what I need. We don't participate in the devious schemes of hell. And people buy that. They're overtaken by that. They think they're getting a deal. We're not getting a deal, Yisrael. Not at all. They got a shirt in there for $10.99, $15. And then you go on that one day, the same shirt is $1.99. I bought them that way. And they're still making money. They're still making money. And then they rob the little poor people of India and China. They work in those factories with the greedy bastards. That they're Mamzir Yisrael. They don't know Yah. And they rob those little poor women that spend 14, 15 hours a day. And we got something to complain about. 14, 15 hours a day in factories don't see their children. Sometimes they must sleep there all night because the quota. For you to go to Walmart to get you a pair of $15 jeans. And they got total process tariff and all, probably $3 and a nickel. They put another 22 cent in it for the employees and all of that. And so the Waltons and the stockholders, then they got $12 a share. The Waltons get 10 and the stockholders divide up the few pennies. And you tell me that's fair, America's fair. Mr. Obama, he wants to take all of our money there. He want to have redistribution. You know, people say that and they're so stupid. You ask them, what is redistribution? How is he going to do it? Well, he's going to take all our money, give it to those that are the lazy, don't want to do nothing. Not what he want to do. But who are those that don't want to do nothing? Who are those? And that's what they got on that's what they got on the mind of the people. He will take all of our money and redistribute it. You don't even have no money. How is he going to take your money when you're poor just like me, man? You're broke. You're disgusted. You don't have a damn nickel. You're living from paycheck to a mobile home. How is he taking your money? You don't have $30 in the bank. I know I don't. So how is he taking your money? He's taking from the rich. They create jobs. The rich don't remember. Ask Mr. Romney. With his Bain Corporation that bought, salvaged, robbed, closed out, and shut down. Why not talk about that, Mr. Romney? I'm going to be hard on China. You're lying because those that spent that $300 million, they make money in China. You think those folks who can give? He had a few donors. Around 60% of all Mr. Romney's money came from powerful organizations, from powerful PACs. They spent $300 million, one PAC. Spent $300+ million. That didn't come from poor white people. It did not come from poor white people. It came from rich, powerful men. There were Arabics, Chinese, whites, and black. That's where it came from. And they know that China, we mess with that. That's where we're making money. We got cheap labor and don't even touch India. That's where the money's coming from, baby. So they knew they had a clown. And so they called Mr. Obama, yet the progressive, they say, well, we have a demand that you raise taxes. We have a demand that you clean the air. Well, come on, stop that. It's all phony, Israel. There's an oligarchy of power, of hierarchy. When they command, they are led by the serpent of hell, which is commanded by Yah, and everything orchestrate. We must remember this. Everything is in the will of Yah. It is not the devil that's in control. It is Yah that is in control. We got to stop thinking like that. Oh, the devil. No, it's Yah, honey. You look at that and say, thank you. There was something I want to show you this week that you can understand. Words are so vital to understand. I'll do it next Shabbat. How about that? How about that? Hallelujah. So we don't have no money for them to take. I don't have a dime. So I have nothing for them to take and to redistrict. None whatsoever. I don't have any. He's taking all the money. Stop it. If he took from you, he wouldn't have no money. We have a large percentage of Americans really don't pay no taxes. I don't think it's the percentage that they say, something like 43%. I don't think it's that, but at least 25% of this nation, they pay no taxes. And they have another 5-6% that does things, or they do things in a way that they're not even detected. White people do that. Rich white men do that. Mr. Romney, come on, his income tax statement, it was 308 pages. Come on, yes, right, y'all. How do you go through 308 pages? He paid less than 13% taxes on hundreds of millions of dollars he made. He got investments in China. You think he's going to cut off his funds from China so his boys can be rich? I wanted to run down there and pop Mr. Obama in the face. You little turd. You couldn't beat nobody. Well, what did you think? I was listening to, he was on Michael Savage's show. I listened to that. You know, I listen to things like that at times. Well, what did you think when Mr. Obama called your father a liar? Well, I wanted to go down there and punch him in the face. Now, that ain't no hood talk, punch him in the face. I'm going to rack him up, baby. I'm going to dog him. That's, you know, that's the real talker there. I wanted to go punch him. Ah, that little sweet sissy talk, punch. Punch him in the face. No, I'm going to dog you, man. The boy said, no. I'm going up in you. If he said, I want to go down and go up in him. Now, then he's talking now. You understand? But I wanted to punch him. You little boy. You little sweet boy. Now, if he said, I want to go down, I want to go up in him. I'm going up in this dog. Now, he'd handle something. I wanted to go down and punch him. But, of course, you know the Secret Service were there. Well, yes, you little boy. He's a little soft sponge bag. Let's be real. Let's get honest about every matter, not just things that pertain. Mr. Obama's not going to do anything for you folks. I don't care what you think. You didn't put him in power, and that's just a fact. I don't think he's going to do anything. He's not going to do anything for black folks, Mexican folks. Forget that. He's doing things for the elite power that placed him there. How about that? So you poor white folks that rich white folks call trash, your agony is no different than the poor Negroes. How about that? Same. Matter of fact, yours worse, because he has to call you that in order to give you some kind of self-esteem. It's just the truth. That's how the word white was by Mr. Brené, and it was in the state of Virginia because of the poor white people. They were thinking that these folks better than us, and they said, no, you are white, and they are black, so you're better because you're white. That's how the whole concept of whiteness has come about. Let's get real. There's no damn white man, no more than a black man. That's why they say they're African Americans. What part? Africa is a huge country. There are 57 recognized countries on the continent of Africa. So what are you? You can't be an African American. Silly mess. Yah barak you all. Come on, Zakim. We greet you all again. May Yah bless you all. May strengthen you all. We appreciate you coming and visiting and stay with us. Our Zakim. All right.
Hallelujah. Yahweh brought y'all, Israel. Let us take heed unto the truth, unto the Torah, what is spoken unto us. Do we not think Yahweh, he hears us? Did he not hear Yisrael and Mizraim, as we heard, because of their afflictions? But don't you know that Yahweh also heard them in the wilderness? And I'm going to talk about that on this coming Kaveh scripture truth, when Yisrael murmured. Do you not think Yahweh did not hear that? He hears the house of Yisrael. So what do you think he expects of us if he hear us, Yisrael? He wants us as a people to hear him, to Shema. Not only do we hear, but we obey what Yahweh commands us to do. So how are we going to move forward today? We must take heed unto his Torah. We must hear, we must Shema. What Yahweh has spoken unto the house today. Hallelujah. So let us obey. Let's be a people that are obedient, that are willing to do what Yahweh commands us, Yisrael. Hallelujah. Is this not a beautiful day? Did not Yahweh give it unto Yisrael, unto the people? Hallelujah. So let's enjoy this day. Let us rest, let us fellowship, and toll to Yahweh for all that he has done, Yisrael. Hallelujah. Let us stand to our feet. We do brought you all to listening by via live stream. Our prayers are with you all. All Yisrael. Hallelujah. That Yahweh would strengthen us as a people and as a nation. Abba Yahweh, we toll you for this beautiful Shabbaton, this day you have given us, Abba Yahweh. Your Torah has gone forth. Your word has spoken, Abba Yahweh. We barak you for that. And as a nation, as a people, Abba Yahweh, we desire to hear that we may grow, that we may do all that you have commanded us to do, that we'll be a people that are pleasing in your sight, and that as we bring an offering unto you, Abba Yahweh, it will be an offering that is sweet, that is pleasant, and that is acceptable in your presence. And all things we do, barak you, we ask that you would go with those that have come from near and far, that you protect them and keep them, Yahweh, above all things. We do give you Todah. In the precious and mighty name of Yahshua HaMashiach, the only name that is given unto Yisrael, unto man, that we can be saved. In all things we do give you Todah. In Yahshua's name we do cry out, hallelujah, 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 Yahweh, hallelujah. Yahweh Barak Kol Yisrael, hallelujah.